Good afternoon. I'm Mary Ann Young. I'm the director of New College Foundation, and I just wanted to welcome you to New College campus. Sherry is actually an alum of New College. We have other alums here with us tonight and students, so we welcome you to the campus. And if you don't know much about New College, we are the public honors college for the state of Florida, which means that we have amazing faculty who teach really smart students. So if you're interested in learning more, yeah, exactly, we'd be happy to talk with you and share more. And it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Uzi Baram, who is professor of anthropology at New College and also the director of our public archaeology lab.
Welcome. As the director of the New College Public Archaeology Lab, much of the research that I've encouraged and directed has focused on documenting historic cemeteries, like the Rosemary Cemetery and Galilee Cemetery, excavations up in Bradenton, the Looking for Angola project, as well as excavations recently in last January at Philippia State Park. The focus is very much on artifacts, landscapes, tangible heritage, with a great concern for both preserving that past, but also trying to use it as an avenue to let people in the community know about the rich heritage in this area. But heritage isn't just tangible, there's also intangible heritage. And when I had the opportunity to bring a speaker to this campus, I was looking for someone who could speak really clearly on the issues of intangible heritage, songs and dance, folklore. When I saw Michael Twitty's work on food, I knew I wanted to bring him here. He's renowned as a food historian with expertise in the foodways of Africa, the African diaspora, the specializations of foodways, the African-American foodways of the American South. He cooks, but he also does a tremendous number of public presentations and interpretations, publishes his work in prestigious venues. If you look on the program, you'll see there is a book forthcoming in November titled The Cooking Gene, which I will encourage you to at least look at, if not to get. His understandings of food, particularly African-American foodways, is tremendously enlightening. What I find really exciting about Michael's work is his recognition of how this heritage work fits in with social justice. The recognition that our knowledge of the past has been fragmented, has been broken into pieces, and Michael is engaging in the work of bringing those pieces together to make sense of them, to make sure the people whose legacies are these foods know of them, and to bring people together through the foods. So without further ado, please provide a nice, warm Sarasota welcome to Michael Twitty.
So he forgot to mention that I'm also a Hebrew school teacher, and that really, not for very long, for the past 12 years, I think I'm done with the whole bar and bat mitzvah preparation process for a while. So that's my other life, is the chocolate chosen. So yes, I am the raisin in the kugel, so it's okay. So this sort of mixture of heritages is very important to me. And before I talk, we're gonna go to the slides in a second. I promise you I won't dwell too much on them. They're just for sort of visual prompt. I had to ask myself, I've been asked the question, how'd you get in the food? And of course, you know how you got the food, your parents, your grandparents. And I guess the first thing I have to say is that I did not like our traditional soul food growing up. when I was little. Part of the reason was it had bones in it and animal parts. And I found out much later that almost everybody feels that way about the food they grew up with, until there's a certain magic point where you either don't ever want it again or you embrace it for the rest of your life. And that was my mother and grandmother's and my father's job. My grandmother, I always knew my grandmother was not my grandmother. My grandmother was her own individual person. So there were always pictures of her when she was little, or when she was getting married, or when she was in high school. So I was never allowed to sort of forget that she was somebody before she made my mother, before my mother made me. And that was really critical, because I would ask her questions about growing up, and not sort of a long time ago kind of way, because it was very clear to me that Grammy came from Big Mama, and Big Mama was before my time, and Big Mama came from Old Lady Joe, and Old Lady Joe came from her mother, Hetty, and Hetty came from Nora. And then the names ran out. So this past couple of years, I've combined this whole search for like food justice and culinary justice. Let me just define some terms. Food justice is about food access. It means that not everybody has access to good quality, healthy food. And people should have access to that, especially if you live in the richest country in the world that throws away an immense amount of healthy, good food every day. It's heartbreaking. Nobody should starve in this country. And two, we've left rural life and farming behind. You know, one of the things that my grandmother hammered into me was that when she was a little girl in Alabama, a horrendously segregated state, which she left. Alabama was my grandmother's Poland. Once she left it, she didn't want to go back. It was horrible. But the one thing she said was, during the Depression, we never starved because we always had control over our food. We couldn't look to anybody else to help us. We couldn't go to the poorhouse because we weren't allowed to go to the poorhouse. Poorhouse was not for colored people. We had to rely on our own. But she said, my mother and father, and this got me. This really got me. And I'll think of it now and try to be a little dry about it. But she said, my mom and daddy went to bed hungry many a night so their 7 children could live. And that made me think, have respect for not just her, but the people who came before her, and go, wow, that's an incredible amount of love, not just for them, but for me as well. So I had to know everything about her and where she came from. And my other grandmother and grandfather, and my grandfather, thank God, Bli Ayin Hora, will be 97 this year. And he has lived to see his great-great-grandchildren be born. Yep, and still walks every day to his church, a mile down the road with his cane now. And he's kind of remarkable. My father was a second of 18. So that's a real Southern family right there. So I just had the pleasure of growing up around people who were really aware of where they came from and wanted me to have that. And I'm just very grateful to them. But I'm also very grateful for the fact I grew up in the outskirts of Washington, D.C. in a very integrated community where there was everybody. I went to my 20th year high school reunion and looked around and said, you know, when I travel to other parts of the country, nobody says they grew up with Iranian, Korean, Venezuelan, Nigerian friends. You know, but we all did. And that was cool. And that's the other way I learned about food, was after school, you go to your friends' houses. And you have to know how to say 5 key phrases in their language. Where's the bathroom? Hello. Thank you. Goodbye. And can so-and-so come out to play? And so as long as you knew those 5 phrases, and you had to know them because the person at the door was usually an extended family member. We didn't do this nuclear family stuff. There was always a grandparent, a cousin, or an uncle or an aunt there. And they would say, you know, in Farsi, budu, budu. You knew that meant, come on, sit down. And then next thing you know, you have a plate of kureshte sabzi or sabzi gourmet in front of you, and you eat. Okay, I'll eat it. You don't say no, right? You eat it. And then you go to your friends who are from Guyana who are Indian. The same thing happens to you. And this is before the internet, so I couldn't just Google, what did I just eat? And take a picture of it and send it around and say, what is this? It was good. I'll know what it was. And then there was the day I went to a friend of mine I went to high school with. I actually saw her after summer after high school, and I ran into her, and she invited me to come have dinner with her family. And her father's African-American, her mother's from Sierra Leone, which happens to be the root of all of my mothers and my mother's side of the family, which is kind of awesome now that I think about it. And her mother was standing at the stove in the kitchen, stirring really slowly this pot of something that smelled really good. And she barely turned her eye to say, when I walked in and said hello, it was like, oh, hello, nice to meet you. Hello. She keeps stirring. And I'm like, that smells really good. What do you call that dish? My first lesson in African, African-American food ways. Sometimes it doesn't have a name. It just is. So she's still stirring, right? Stirring, 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 stirring. And I said, what do you call that dish? She goes, stop stirring. Like, you know, at 9 o'clock. And then she goes, I call it dinner. And then she keeps stirring. So I learned my lesson real quick. You know, everything has a name, everything has a recipe. I should have known that already because I had the grandmother who taught me how to make a teaspoon and tablespoon, half teaspoon in my palm of my hand perfectly. And used to cut tomatoes in her hand, never used a cutting board, which I've cut myself several times doing. And then I learned how to actually do it. And I said, ah, now I understand what's behind it. And always asking people of all ages about their food traditions. The first thing I'm going to talk to you about if I sit down with you at a table. What's your favorite thing to eat? Who taught you how to cook? Do you not cook at all? If you don't cook, who do you eat from? All these questions. And you learn a lot about somebody because, you know, part of your knowledge and your intelligence and your spiritual intelligence isn't here. It's in your kishkas. It's in your guts. There's a reason for that. There's a reason why some of those feelings you've had your whole life when something was really important, you didn't feel it here. You felt it in your belly, because that's where your spiritual intelligence is, where those bacteria in your gut have brains of their own. And so all of those food memories and all those loves and victories and accomplishments and all those traumas that our ancestors passed down to us are still in our DNA. They're still changing us. They're still shaping us. And it's the most amazing thing to sort of like braid together the food history, the genetic history, the genealogy, and the social politics of food. So what I talk about is culinary justice. Now, I were explaining to you that food justice is focusing on food access, you know, the health and quality of the food. Culinary justice works a slightly different way. It's asking the question, in our contemporary food scene, we have a lot of people doing various ethnic cuisines. But unlike 100 years ago or even 50 years ago, an ethnic cuisine is not necessarily represented by someone who looks like that cuisine. And this is a very touchy subject because food is a big business because everybody has to eat. But also, food can be a tremendous opportunity for people to have empowerment and uplift. We know that. We know that Italian families built, you know, family dynasties on mom and pop places and restaurants. We know that the Chinese American community still, to this day, has those Chinese restaurants are not informally organized. It's actually an old tradition going back to the turn of the 20th century, where you would come to America, someone would kind of figure out where the next Chinese restaurant needed to be. And much like in the Roma, the Gypsy community, you don't go to the same corner as the your other people. You go to the next town. So you ever wonder why there's like only so many Chinese restaurants in Fargo, North Dakota? There's a reason for that. It's an informally organized, almost like a chain system. And that's how people work their way up and work their way to be able to provide college for their children and other opportunities. Well, what if you're African American? We know those stories. what if you're African American? For several hundred years, our forefathers and foremothers worked without a paycheck. And then for another 100 years, they were the help. They were the underpaid domestics. There was not a single woman in my family from that generation that did not at one point or another cook for white people. And they were never paid what they were worth. And then we had the civil rights movement. And between those two time periods, a lot of the professional cooks were black people. Jacques Pepin, Pierre Frenet, the same French cooks who worked alongside, inspired, and learned from Julia Child, both said when they came to this country, you went into a gourmet kitchen anywhere in America, most of the cooks were going to be black men. That is not the case today. We have an informally educated, mostly Latino staff, who may or may not be documented workers. And we have a largely formally educated white male staff, people who can afford a culinary degree. So when civil rights happened, two things happened. Number one, it became not so fashionable in the black community to have those jobs because you were the help. We wanted to be doctors, lawyers, teachers, professors. We wanted to be businessmen. We wanted that role. We did not want to have a tray in our hands for any reason. And at the same point in time, over a 10 to 15 year period, and then by the time you got to the end of civil rights, about 75 to 80, then the chef becomes, if you can really make it in the chef trade, you can become a millionaire. Interesting how that millionaire thing happened after we left in droves. And those of us who stayed in the business gave up, a lot of us gave up on soul food and Southern food and African food and West Indian food because we didn't want to get pegged down as, oh, that's all we can do. We wanted to prove that we could do sushi and we could do high quality French food as we always had. And what people never realized is we were the first. James Hemings, who knows that name, James Hemings? A good handful of people in the audience. That was Sally Hemings' brother. He was enslaved to Thomas Jefferson. He was also his wife's half-brother. And he was brought at the age of 19 to France by Thomas Jefferson from Virginia. He had never left the Chesapeake region. And he became a tutor, he became tutored to the cooks at the court of Versailles. So nobody in early America had as much culinary education as this young black man who came back to America, taught his family what he learned in those kitchens over a several year period, who was also fluent in French and Spanish and English, and then he got his freedom. Jefferson reluctantly signed his emancipation record saying, I paid at great cost to myself for his education. Really, Thomas. Yeah, that's nice. But when you think about when I was growing up and I learned about American culinary history, I learned about how Thomas Jefferson had introduced America to steak and French fries. And Thomas Jefferson introduced vanilla ice cream. And Thomas Jefferson introduced macaroni and cheese. Really, Thomas Jefferson didn't introduce nothing. All we know that because James Hemings could write and read. And he wrote in his own hand those very recipes that those early encyclopedias, you know, look it up in your Funkin' Wagnalls, those early encyclopedias said that Thomas Jefferson introduced them. Thomas Jefferson was too busy flirting and getting drunk. And he didn't speak French that well either, other than five expressions. Hello, goodbye, where is the bathroom? What time is dinner? And is your husband here? I said it. So, but James, I always do something naughty every time. But James was really something, and so was Hercules, George Washington's chef. And then if you notice, there's a long list of well-dressed, very successful black men and women who were cooks, caterers, and chefs in early America. So long, in fact, that you almost have to ask yourself, was anybody else doing this job before American food was completely changed in the age of Ellis Island. We were it. if you wanted a big wedding, we were the only possible, we were it. Nobody trusted you unless you had one of these, you know, finely dressed, well-spoken, gold-tipped cane having black caterers in their family do your cooking for you. With the understanding, these were not the help. These were culinary professionals who would tell you what you were going to eat, as opposed to you dictating to them what they would cook. So that's the kind of mentality I want young African-Americans to see, that they come from culinary greatness. They come from people who did the original whole animal cooking. Nothing makes me angrier, ladies and gentlemen, than to see articles about our food, and they'd say things like, collard greens are the new kale. Really? Or whole animal cooking. Okay, we just called that chitlins back in the day. Pig feet, tail. What we did was nasty, gross chitlins. Apparently when you do it, it's whole animal cooking. And there's just, it's a whole language of obfuscation, whole language removing us from, you know, local eating farm to table. Excuse me, but I don't think my grandmother and her mother 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 knew was farm to table. It's called a plantation, but they had farm to table. Y'all can laugh at that one, it's okay. I give you permission. But that's true, right? And that same could be said for most rural, you know, peasant, we have to use the word, Americans. They were farm to table because they had no choice. They had to be self-reliant in some way or some form, which also means you know where the food came from. I did a program with the Smithsonian one time where I had a garden, and the little boy comes up, little redhead boy, and he says, "What's that?" And I said, "That's corn." And his mother was so embarrassed because the little boy said, "That's not corn. Corn comes from a can." Ooh. I'm not going to call child services because you could get things corn. A lot of kids don't know. A lot of teenagers and other, they don't know what strawberries, what a proper strawberry tastes like. Because that's another part of our problem. But the culinary justice angle is what we're going to explore. And I'm going to go ahead, we're going to go ahead and do the slide so I can get us out of here on time. All right, let's do that. Okay, so how do I know all this stuff and how did I get here? I basically had to, over the past decade and a half, become the first black cook to focus on colonial antebellum foodways since the Civil War. And what that meant was going beyond the food that my grandparents and my other elders taught me about, but looking at the roots of that food, going all the way back to West and Central Africa. And my goal is that not only would chefs of color be more informed about where our food comes from, because more of us are embracing and exploring soul food, Southern food, West Indian and African food these days than ever before, but also letting people know that, yes, I realize that there are white male chefs who are authorities in other people's cuisines, but you ain't never gonna find a better authority in my cuisine other than me and my kinfolk. And that's critical, because it really bites when you go to write an article about something or talk about something or cook something, and someone brings up the name of a white celebrity chef and said, "What are you doing differently from what they're doing?" Excuse me, I was born in this club. They joined that club. There's a difference. And so that sort of thing, sorry, that's my Jewish side coming out too. Because honestly, the one thing that protected Jewish food was kashrut. We didn't, you know, you notice there's not a whole lot of other people doing deli culture. You know, that doesn't really happen that way. Why? Because we still have a sense of that belongs to them. Now, that may be true, it may not be true. But we don't really have the sense that this food really belongs to this formerly enslaved people who were exploited to the nth degree, who were stolen and kidnapped and abused and maligned. We sort of still believe that that's free for the taking, kind of like rock and roll, the banjo and blues, right? Because remember Pat Boone, the whole rock and roll? Yeah, it was sad. But I don't want any more crossover. I want respect, mutual respect. It's okay if other people borrow from, quote, and engage with our food culture. It is not okay if they steal it, appropriate it, claim it as their own, like Paula Deen used to do till I got her. Talking about her grandmother invented hoe cake, please, honey. You won't try again sometime. No, I had to take that right on back. So when people respect each other's cultures and they respect the tenets of the culture, then it's cool. It's okay. We can have a mutually respectful, responsible dialogue from one ethnicity to the next. I don't use the term race. I don't believe in the term race. It's one human race. But ethnicity is very real because ethnicity is history, it's genes, it's social culture, context, etc. So for me, I felt like I had to own our history and own the path to where we got to. Because for a lot of African Americans, the historical plantation is a very scary place. Why wouldn't it be? These are our labor camps. This is where a lot of horrific things happened to our forefathers and foremothers. But I have asked our people to come back to these places where the most lucrative American cuisine was created, Southern food. It's lucrative because it makes billions upon billions of dollars, whether you're talking about the lowest common denominator, fast food. How many Pacific Northwest fast food restaurants do you know of? But I bet you know about some KFC, some Popeyes, some churches, and some Bojangles. How many New England chain restaurants do you know of? Yeah, think about it. I hear crickets mating. It's so quiet in here. But you know about a Cracker Barrel and a Waffle House. How many fine restaurants? There are plenty of fine restaurants of those other genres, Southwest, etc. But how many of those states make over a quarter or half their tourism budget based on food alone, like you see in the Deep South? So I'm reclaiming something that has made the American South not only famous, but extraordinarily rich. And the seeds were planted in the days of slavery. So that's at Somerset Place Plantation, North Carolina. And these two little girls were a lot of fun. They are the great-granddaughters of a woman whose ancestors were enslaved at this plantation, which goes back to the late 1700s. And I was showing them how to pound rice. And rice is a very important crop to me because rice, ladies and gentlemen, was the technology to grow it, the making of the dikes and pushing the fresh water in and pulling the salt water back. All of that system and the actual practice of growing the rice and processing it was originally brought in the minds and bodies of Africans from Senegal, from Sierra Leone, from Liberia, and other places. These are my mother's people, the Mende of Sierra Leone. I learned that through DNA testing. And just to see them on this former rice plantation with this mortar and pestle, you could see the ancestors smiling because they know these girls will not forget where they came from. So for me, it's been about learning the process. Our young people learn from textbooks that bore the hell out of them because they don't relate to them. And then I start showing young folks images like this, high quality digital images of me and my fellow historians doing the work. So I grew up learning how to grow tobacco from my father, who worked tobacco and cotton as a child. He was born and raised in D.C., but every summer he had to go back and help the relatives. That was our summer camp. We couldn't pay for summer camp, so we went back down south. That was how we grew up. And it continued with me. And so learning how to do this was something, both he and I take great pride in. My father is going to be 76 this year. My father used to say to me, I was the only kid in D.C. with merit badges in growing cotton and tobacco. It's really funny. And there I am at 19, my first time putting tobacco up in the barn, and with my book in hand. So I'm the same person I always was. Rice field in South Carolina. Carolina Gold Rice made millionaires out of rice planters who basically imported a knowledgeable workforce in West Africa to grow the crop for them. If you could have two successful rice crops anywhere between lower North Carolina and northern Florida, you were a millionaire, colonial millionaire. That's why Charleston was the cultural capital of the South, only bested by Philadelphia. And that's only because of the climate, which is full of mosquitoes and heat. And by the way, I'm wearing sandals in that picture. I don't know why, because there are mosquitoes and there are poisonous snakes and there are alligators, which I found out real quick when I went through that rice field. They're baby alligators, but still, they're not fun either. But you can eat them if you catch them. They were Mahalia Jackson's favorite food. So I teach historians about how the food was cooked, and I have been known to pick cotton at least once a year. I try to pick at least 300 pounds because that's what a man my size and age would be expected to pick. In about 10 years, I can cut it down to 250. And 10 years after that, half that amount, and so forth. And what really got me was when I learned that the pregnant women had to pick almost as much as the men. That, you know, was mind-boggling. There was no mercy. And so you could understand that how these women would often have children who were underweight. They weren't being fed enough. They were getting half the ration that a woman got. Women didn't get fed as much as men. And it made me feel like it's a miracle any of us are here because of that. And so when I did my research on my own family history, I actually looked up how much cotton the plantations they were on produced in the U.S. Census. And it blew me away, because you had to figure out how many acres does it take to make a bale. And now that I've actually done the work of growing and picking cotton, what would that have been like? And so how does a diet change as you're moved across the South from one corner to the next? And so asking all those really personal questions have enabled me to benefit my work. So when you get into these colonial and antebellum kitchens, you're confronted with 60 different utensils plus to cook the food. So these are not fun gadgets. These are really difficult, clunky, heavy items that get really hot really fast. And you spend a lot of time, smelling the hair on your arms burnt off because it singes off. And it's not from the fire. It's from the fact that that brick is at a radiated heat. So your hair is being singed not from the fire, which you learn how to respect really, really quickly because you can see it. But the invisible heat you don't ever get used to. You put your hand in there. And by the way, that's how you test how hot the oven was. You put your bare arm in. And if it takes 30 seconds, you can stand 30 seconds, it's hot, not hot enough. You put it in, it's 15 seconds, it's hot enough. So I had to learn all these little skills from people who actually do it at historical sites, off and on as volunteers. I read every single historic cookbook there was to read about the South. And I read every single narrative that the WPA narratives of slaves they left behind. And things that my grandmother and mother taught me about growing up. All kind of put together with any elders I could finally talk to. So if you're wondering what's in the picture, that's the start of okra soup. And everybody had okra soup until the days of canning. Then all of a sudden, no more okra soup, which is a really great, healthy summer vegetable soup. And those are black-eyed pea cakes. Which, by the way, are direct carryover from Nigeria. In Nigeria, they call them akara. But you don't know this if you're not digging into the history. So I was the first person at Colonial Williamsburg. I do not work there, but I do consultations for them and do special programs. Get brought in as a special scholar to do a colonial style barbecue the way they would have done it. And so those were living trees that we chopped down with a hatchet, a colonial hatchet I might mention, which takes a while, and a hole we dug that's about 5 feet deep, and we built a tremendously huge fire from oak and hickory wood. And that's another part. You have to know the different types of wood. These were very skilled workers. One of the things I regret the most, when I was growing up in school, we were taught that the slaves were unskilled labor. That is the biggest lie in American history. Would you really let someone build your country and fix your food that was unskilled labor? Get out of here. They were more skilled than the pickpockets from Liverpool and Bristol they brought over here in the first place. Get out of here with that. So you dig that hole, you put those living saplings on top of it. You have to know what kind of wood to use, because red oak and white oak don't burn the same.
don't have the same smoke and flavor that come off of them. One is cleaner than the other. You have to know what type of maple to cut down, what type of ash. You have to know what type of evergreen can start a fire and what type of evergreen you never want around a fire at all. It's a very intricate knowledge of every little step in the process. And the food is seasonal. So you have to know how to make the seasons blend together and stretch. And you have to have a sense of the environment around you, the rhythm of nature. One of the things that really got me, I taught Holocaust for a number of years in a Reform and Conservative synagogue. And one of the things that grabbed me the most about this one woman who had recorded an interview with a Shoah survivor was she said that she found out the Nazis were coming when she was out in the woods picking mushrooms. And as a food person, that really got to me because I immediately asked the question, how long had they been in that part of Poland? And I said, it had to be a very long time. Because she knew which mushrooms were okay, which ones were not. And she was, you know, at harmony in the woods. She said that Jewish community had been there for 800 years. And I said, from that one sentence, I knew that. Because there's a certain thing that happens when you're a pioneer in the land, when you forage. And now foraging is a big thing. It's a big bragging right. I forage. Well, so did my grandmama. You know, she picked blackberries. And I learned how to do that from my daddy. And, you know, come on now. That this is called survival. It's called appreciating God for everything he gives you. So, same deal. We've been there so long that we knew what things we could use, what things we couldn't use. And so the barbecue takes place over, that's 8 or 9 hours of cooking. I didn't bring any for y'all, I'm sorry. Hey, y'all think it's gonna be like Oprah and you're gonna go with your seat and get a, you're sadly mistaken, I do apologize. Maybe next time. And we made, you know, the seasoning and, you know, season the meat with it from the pot. And people were, they were just upset because we couldn't give them any of the food. It was all for the staff. The staff tore it up. We didn't have anything left by the time we were done. But then I, you know, show people this comes from a place. You know, I got in trouble. I wrote an article for The Guardian where I talked about the roots of barbecue. People wanted to tear my head off. Because I said the barbecue came from these maroon communities that lived in the outskirts of Southern West Indian and Brazilian culture, where they were slowly smoking this meat. You see that? This is in West Africa. But you can imagine, I mean, you don't have to imagine anything. I was on a show with Andrew Zimmern, the one who does the Bizarre Food Show, and a couple shows before me, he was in Suriname, and the people in Suriname were doing the exact same thing you see right in front of you. And those people were descendants of people who ran off to the rainforest to escape the plantations on the coast. The Maroons, the same ones who invented jerk chicken in Jamaica and the jerk pork in Jamaica. The same tradition that began American Southern barbecue. And I had people want to tear my head off. My favorite quote was this. Mr. Twitty is less welcome at my barbecue than an evangelical vegan. I'm proud of that. So, you know, this is our tradition. Harper's Weekly, 1871. You know, Bubba ain't in this picture. Barbecue pit master Bubba ain't nowhere to be found in this picture. It's very clear the message we're being sent about who cooks the food and who cooks the food best. I'm not saying Bubba can't cook the barbecue. I'm just saying that it didn't start with him and ain't gonna finish with him either. And that's just all she wrote. So when I go to these plantations, I try to orchestrate some things. For example, this is Montgomery, Alabama, where my, where my great-great-great-grandmother, Hetty, was enslaved after being born in Charleston, South Carolina. And people don't seem to notice that there is a bell and keys. Well, you know who's running that show. The wife of the plantation owner, slaveholder. The bell to call, the keys to prohibit her folks from getting into things. And so I wanted to create images like this. We did a whole series where we actually were at a North Carolina plantation near Charlotte. And that's actual food, and those are actual black people, of which I am one. That's an actual white girl, and that's an actual plantation table. And all, everything in that room except for us was there when the Yankees showed up at age 65. Everything. We couldn't put the food down on the table. We couldn't touch anything. She barely could use the chair for 5 minutes. But we recreated this entire scene from antebellum slavery. Because there's a certain value in not forgetting, and a certain value in really understanding things for what they were. And that was not cold food. That was right out of the hearth. We did the whole process as if it really was that time period. And we really also wanted to understand the dynamics of what that meant. And so we made more barbecue that day. Cat had biscuits, which I assure you don't contain any actual cat. They're just as big as a cat's head. That's what they call cat head biscuits. Kush, which is one of everybody's favorite thing to eat. When I make these big dinners, people pay a lot of money to come to them. The thing they love the most is kush, and I think it's really hilarious because kush is what was made from when you took cornbread, which was always made from white cornmeal, by the way. It was never made from yellow cornmeal. And it was the day leftover, and you crumbled it up with onions and, you know, some kind of fat, usually hog fat, lard, and hot pepper, and whatever herbs you had, and stir it up in a pan, like a hash, like a dry hash. People go nuts over this stuff. They say, what is that? I want to do that. And it basically costs like $5 to make. If you do it, you know, even if you were to go to Whole Foods, it'd still be a $5 meal, right? Just that dish alone. I think it's funny. Hoppin' John, which is right out of West Africa. You know, peas and rice put together. And I think we did a stuffed quail, and we did rabbit that day too. And whatever, they had squash, other vegetables, okra in the garden in Hominy. So yeah, we made an actual full-on meal that people ate, and you know, that's the way it is. I'm gonna speed up and go to our justice component in like 5 minutes, but I do wanna show you this. Does anybody know what that thing is called? It's a fan, great, it's a fan. That's good. So it is a fan, but has a very specific name. It's called a punkah. And that name comes from the British colonial rule in India. And punkah literally means wing in Hindi. And it was what the Maharajas would be fanned with in their court. And the British took this up as like part of the colonial heritage. And somehow it made it to the American South. If you notice, there is a string going from the punkah to the wall to that chair. That string was where the little enslaved boy would pull the fan to cool the diners at table. My great-great-grandfather, Elijah Mitchell, did that. Only in his case, I think they had an actual, the people who held him in bondage were not rich. That is solid mahogany that was carved by an enslaved craftsman. And people walk into this room and go, oh my, look at that. And I had to get on the staff's case because I said to them, the National Park Service, and I said, don't just allow people to walk in here and brag about this mahogany thing. You tell them, first of all, that an enslaved craftsman did that. And you, second of all, you tell them that you don't even know his name. You don't know who his children were, who his woman was, who his daddy was, who his mama was, where they came from. But you know that you have the largest and most intricate punkah in the entire antebellum South. You know that much. You know everything else but the name of the man who carved it. And second point, what was this for? What social boundaries did it set up? Just like that bell and those keys, right? There were actual swings. I'm not making this up. There were swings from the ceiling. Usually a little girl, a skinny little girl, black girl, would be put in the swing, and she would have a peacock feather fan. And the swing would go back and forth, and she fanned the people and the flies on the table. That's, you know, thinking about my great-great-grandfather doing this is very deep. Very deep. Because he was, you know, he had a really great life after slavery. He educated himself, you know, was a landowner, church deacon. He taught his wife and his children how to read and write. All his children went to some level of school. And he was the first generation to see freedom. And here's the best part. He went from doing this to watching the surrender of Lee to Grant at Appomattox, because his plantation was right down the road. And so I like to think that my great-great-grandfather and his brother were the first people to know the nightmare of slavery was over. And the family history records, the minute they found out they were free, they started acting up. Got on the horse, went down the road telling everybody that they were free. People didn't believe him. And my great-great-grandfather got land from his former slaveholder. And that's the land that was part of the land that my grandmother was born on. So things do move forward in life. You just have to be patient. Now, for my nutritionist in the room, I'm looking at you. I had a question about the diet. How does a diet affect health, right? And so this is pretty much most of, but not all, of the African diet at the time of contact with European slave traders. Now, you'll notice there's not a lot of fresh meat on that table or animal fat. That's a biggie. You will also notice there are no plants, no grains on that table that are glutinous. So you think about this. There's sugarcane on the table, but in its raw form. There are fruits on that table and vegetables on the table and spices, and there are root tubers, and there are fruits, and there are things from all over the world because Africa was at the center. One of the biggest myths about Africa and food is it was always famine prone. That didn't happen until the colonial period when people were forced to work on plantations in Africa, coffee plantations, groundnut or peanut plantations, rubber plantations, they wouldn't have access to their own farms and fields. But let's go back to this time period. These are pretty healthy people with a pretty healthy diet. Even the palm oil that they use in their diet isn't that bad for them. We're going to skip all that because we don't have time for that. But I'll just wet your whistle with this. He is the only black person who's ever FedExed back to Africa. Because he could read and write. I'm not making this up. He ran away from slavery. He could read and write, and they sent him right on back. And how do we know this? Because he told the people on the way back his story. Look him up later on Google. All right. So look at that again. That's seasoning. Meat was a condiment. It was not the whole diet. So we came into a diet that was based on what? Bread and meat, like the British, right? Bread and meat and heavy food that we hadn't eaten in 70,000 years. I wanted to repeat that, just so you got the point. We had very little dairy in our diet because most of us were lactose intolerant. And those of us who could have dairy was often fermented, which is really good for you. Fermented forms of dairy, like yogurt and buttermilk, et cetera, cultured forms of milk. And there was only so much salt in the diet. And we didn't have a lot of gluten in the diet at all. And no processed sugar. So why do African Americans have such high rates of hypertension, diabetes, certain kind of cancers? Because we weren't meant to eat gluten. That's not me preaching a gospel. I actually went to a nutritionist conference, and one guy pulled me aside and said, did you read those papers? And I said, no. And he said, you're on to something. He said, sub-Saharan Africans have the greatest gluten intolerance of anybody on earth. So when you're putting this stuff in your body, it's not reacting to it. It's not like, oh, hey, I had a piece of bread. Oh, hey, I had a donut. No, it's wreaking havoc. The minute it gets in your mouth, the time it comes out. So this is why our men have so much prostate cancer, pancreatic cancer is so high. Our women don't have the same breast cancer, by the way, because we have a few different genes working. So some of the same methods that you might use to heal breast cancer in a European American woman might not work in an African American woman because it's not the same mutation on certain chromosomes that produces the same disease. So it's really critical that we know about this food thing and health thing because it's a way out. It's changed the way I've done things. I'm a big guy. I come from big people. But I also realize that, you know, there's a certain point where you don't want to go down the route that has taken out so many people in your family because of certain dietary habits. You always have to be very aware of these things. And so this is not just about knowing where you come from and being economically viable. It's also about saving lives. My friend Ron Finley says that drive-throughs kill more black people than drive-bys. And he's right. And the fact that you can remember that phrase will help you in the future to understand the importance of food. So yeah, and our food was active. It was stirring and it was pounding grain and it was walking to wells. It was a very active process. And all of it had elements of our spirituality in it. It wasn't just making food because you're hungry. The food process making is all part of the mythological system of African cultures. It's fascinating to see that. So, yeah. You know that top pot looks like grits, don't it? It's actually fufu. But I'll show that black folks and they go, oh my God, that's grits. I'm like, yeah, you've been eating the same food for thousands of years, it's true. And that's our root of our gumbo, a stew made with okra and chicken. I'm gonna bypass some stuff. But that's North Carolina in the 1930s. That, as soon as the West Africans, they go nuts. They go, wait a minute. That's like my great-grandmother's village. And I said, mm-hmm. We kept these things. These things didn't change. Didn't change for centuries upon centuries upon centuries. We kept a lot of the words, too. And we sold our food in New Orleans, in Bahia, in Brazil, in Philadelphia. We weren't just the caterers and the chefs. We were the original fast food on the streets with our okra soup and other good things. Those are just some of the things we foraged. And just to make one small point before we move on, that's the African version of the American persimmon. The same species and same genus, different species. So when I talked about our ancestors foraging and making connections between what they knew and what they found, that's an intricate process because you see in every book, but no one tells you actually what plants. So I'm working through that right now. And also the medicinal practices. The leaves of the American persimmon are full of vitamin C. And I specifically remember my grandmother who died at 94 a couple years ago from Virginia saying that she would take the leaves and make a tea out of them when you felt sick. And then she also said that the green persimmon, when they were teenagers, when they got pimples, they'd rub the green persimmon on them because they were astringent. And the acid would kill the pimple. So all these little things my grandmother taught me, both of them, about how to heal yourself are also important. And these were their gardens. I mean, I hate to say this, but we had more gardens in slavery than we do today. We had more access to fresh food by our own will and volition than we do today. And that's a big part of the problem. So when we restore culinary justice, we also restore food justice. We make it possible for people to have a different way out. And that's where our food was born, our little cabins, dirt floors, small brick hearths, maybe two pots available to you, and a skillet. That's it. That's where Southern food was born. And these small slave cabins where my forefathers and foremothers were from. Sometimes you didn't have that. The basic diet, salt pork, salt fish, and unbalted corn. 2 gallons per person per week. If you're a woman, cut that in half. If you're a child, cut that in half. So yeah, it's not much. So you had to make a way out of no way. You had to make do with what you had. And just think about the fact that this is the number one regional cuisine in America, crafted in the hands of African people, from Maryland to Louisiana, from Texas to Missouri to Florida. Yeah. So one of the ways I learn about this food is not just the doing, it's also collecting images of artifacts, looking at art. Now, when you were growing up, you saw still art, still paintings in elementary school. You thought to yourself, how dumb is that? It's a picture of fruit. And now I know that's the greatest thing to study heirloom vegetables and fruits. Because we don't have Polaroids of what they look like. We don't have videos. We don't have digital shots on a smartphone. But we do have still life paintings that show us how the fruit looked inside and out, and what varieties look like, how they changed over time. And those paintings they're both by the Peale brothers who painted George Washington, Jefferson, and the like. All three of those are from plantations in Maryland. And so I was able to look at them and go, oh my God, that's cowhorn okra, and that's stubby okra, and that's Jersey Stonehand cabbage. And that's a Georgia rattlesnake watermelon. And that over there is a Virginia gourd seed corn, ear corn, and Arundel muskmelon. And that's a Puerto Rico sweet potato. You can tell that much detail just by looking at the pictures. A friend of mine, I forget Tom's last name, because he goes by Dr. Apples. He's about 80 years old. This white gentleman from Virginia. And he can tell you anything you want about apples. He has over 400 apples in his orchard in Lynchburg, 400 apple trees, every different variety. He grafts them himself and knows every single history behind them. And the coolest thing he ever taught me was that if you take, there was a certain kind of apple that they only grew just because it smelled good. And you know, and because you didn't have, you know, you didn't have Febreze back in his day. And so he said this to me, and I told him, I said, you know what the word tapuach in Hebrew means apple, but it comes from the word, it comes from the root word, the shoresh, is to something that smells nice. So he's like, ah, yeah, that's why Eve picked it. You got a. The sermon will be next Shabbos. It's okay. All about that. The bones, the archaeological sites, they contain the bones. And all these slave cabins are there. Plantal and animal remains. You know, over 200 some species people use to eat. You know, like this guy. You know he's going to show up. The Chazer. And then these guys. And then the four food groups. Of which rabbit is the best, I assure you. The other are kind of interesting to eat. And the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, you know, as Jesus said, and all the rest. And so we were talking about the gardens earlier, Uzi. That's how they grew them. In front of my little garden shed. That's how they, all together, not in little rows. It conserves water. It conserves soil. It cuts down on insect infestation. And you can have safe space. Isn't that cool? All right. So I kind of want to switch to the next thing because I want to make sure we have enough time to see that. Because I want you all to see what's going on the other side of things. We do have good models of what can happen in the future, not just the past. So we kind of want to go to the next set. Thank you. I thought you'd get that cue. I want to take you through a little visual tour of Gilead Farms. This is one project among the many that I've been blessed to document to show you where black chefs and farmers are taking things today. And this is the heart of what we were supposed to be talking about anyway, so. That logo's kind of creepy, but okay. It's like, wow, the murder, the most important part, is it the growing? So everybody had a grape arbor back in the days of my grandmother's. And, you know, Muscadine, Scuppernong grapes. And then you look at that and go, okay, they're growing grapes. Then Matthew Rayford, who is an amazing chef and intellect, he told me, culinary school only taught me how to do one thing. Say everything my grandmother taught me to do in the kitchen in French. So I paid a lot of money for that. But he's really cool because he does what his elders taught him to do. Put the shells, he's in the low country of Georgia, in Brunswick, Georgia, near the coast. Take those oyster shells and clam shells and crab shell and shrimp and put them down there. And what that does is it kills the nematodes that attack the roots of the soil. But we had always done that. I found references to that in books talking about West Africa going back 400 years. And I'm just like, it's amazing how many things get carried over. And so he's growing some of these, you know, traditional herbs that we use for healing. That's a press to extract the juice from sugar cane. He's growing sugar cane down there now. That's the Carolina gold rice. And both of us come from rice growing heritage people from the low country, of South Carolina. He has all these fishermen, whenever they get like fish bones and trash fish, et cetera, they're not going to use, they bring them to his compost pile. That's some of the richest compost you ever get. And he puts that out there, no Miracle-Gro, completely organic farm. And I'm seeing this all over the South, not just where he is. I'm seeing this in Baltimore, in Houston, in New Orleans, in St. Louis. I'm seeing it in Mobile, Alabama, in Montgomery, in Birmingham, in Atlanta. People are really serious about this. Winston-Salem, Durham, Richmond, this is a real passion. because people are waking up to the fact that they need to have more control over their food system, and it needs to be a culturally based food system. It needs to be something they can understand, appreciate, and own, and pass down to their children. And it's a place where the elders and the young people actually can dialogue and meet, and they can learn from each other and be support for one another. A lot of our elders, they don't have anywhere to go. They're stuck in the community. They're just sitting, they're softening. But then you get them in the garden, and all of a sudden, they come back to life again. And they're sitting, teaching people, and then, you know, the blood pressure goes down, and all of a sudden, those people in the community garden become their family. And it's the most beautiful thing you've ever seen. Because now they're not just the grandmother of their grandchildren, they're the grandmother of the whole community. It takes a village. We still see this. So he plants his crops. That's that Georgia rattlesnake watermelon you saw in the painting. Sugar cane. And he also maintains all the natural plants on his... Gilliard was his great-great-grandfather, who was emancipated from slavery, who was born 1812, Jupiter Gilliard. And so he maintains all the wild plants, like the huckleberry, on the land and makes food from it. This guy is no small potatoes. He represented the United States at the Slow Food Convention and in Milan in Italy. So he's representing the whole country to the best gourmets and gourmands in the world in Italy. So he's bringing them huckleberry pie they've never had before. And get this, a barbecue sauce made with watermelon molasses. You take the juice from the watermelon and you cook it down till it becomes a syrup. And you use that to sweeten the onions and the tomatoes and everything else. So he's kind of a genius. I like him. So this was this is a farmer's market in Southwest Atlanta, in the inner city of Southwest Atlanta, where there are corner stores and churches and nothing else. There are no grocery stores. And so this community now has a farmer's market. This gentleman's from Montezuma, Georgia, third generation farmer in his family. And he just gave me a thing of chow chow, which is awesome. Those of you Southern folk know about chow chow. And the corn and the okra and the black-eyed peas and fresh field peas. And fresh field peas make dried black-eyed peas look like, you know, stepchildren five times removed. It's just so good. But this gentleman was fascinating, the gentleman in the hat. He was actually from my grandparents' hometown of Birmingham. And he said to me, he saw my little pouch around my neck, and he said, you know, when I went up north, I decided to move up north. My grandmother gave me two things. She gave me a little pouch like you have around your neck to protect me from bad luck. And she gave me a shoebox filled with fried rabbit. And that's how I went up north, and I became a bus driver and sent all my kids to college. Now I live back down south again. And so I recorded, while I'm sitting there, you know, there's chefs in the background who are African-American, who are male. And this is very important because you know who is coming to this farmer's market? All these young men who otherwise might be on the corner, you know, between the ages of 12 and 18. And that's where they're hanging out. That's where they want to spend their time. And they have these chefs who are teaching them how to cook, you know, about my age, you know, 20s through late 30s, and they're showing them how to cook and do different things, and they let the kids peel, and the kids can't wait for the taste of the food, and where the vegetables coming from, these farmers. So they got to see the whole process. And not only that, but her particular site is also a farm, an urban community farm. This lady was killer. She's from Jamaica. She saw a kid walk in with a Arizona iced tea, and she said, she almost threw it out of his hands. She said, try this hibiscus. She said, what you got in your hands ain't nothing but dirty water. And she was awesome, amazing, amazing. So she teaches her culture, which is similar to our culture, to the kids who come to this farm. So there I'm interviewing him. I mean, I sat with him for an hour, videotaping and writing down, and I do this all the time. And he was amazing, this gentleman. They made succotash that day. So these chefs were some of the finest restaurants in Atlanta, and they're volunteering 5 hours of their time to come teach his kids how to cook. So it was awesome. There's some of the young men right there just, you know, chilling. I mean, I saw 30 of them, and all these young women come in too. It just blows the mind. This lady,
was a vegan caterer, and that is a coconut lime vegan pound cake. How, I don't know, but it was good. I promise you that, and her son, Heru. And this is my favorite picture of all. But the bottom line was, they had an organization called the Habeshah. We also helped them plant, the kids plant their own seeds at the farm. 60, you know, third to fifth grade kids. I'll never do that again. But I did my part, I can deal with 10, but not 60. But the bottom line is, goats are evil. look at that. Right. So that's another farm near the King Center, actually. And it's 4 acres. 4 acres. And it's got everything, banana trees, everything. It's all organic. And people come to the market and get their okra and get their chicken eggs and everything else. And the organization that the vegan caterer made food for a benefit, Habeshah, this is cool. So the farmer from Montezuma, Georgia, saw her produce, right? Then she turned around, cooked the produce, made food, gave a third of her earnings to support this organization along with many other community groups. And they train teenagers in another part of Atlanta, also in an area that's you know, depleted of food resources. They come there, they learn how to grow food, learn how to recycle, learn how to make manure tea and compost. They learn about the nutrients in their food. They understand that the food is fuel as well as something that's good to eat, as well as their cultural heritage. And after they're done learning with them for 2 years, that group gets to go all paid expenses to Africa for 2 weeks. They go to Ethiopia and they go to Ghana. Then they come back with the promise they're going to teach the next group. And it's all supported by the community. I was blown away. This is the best thing I had ever seen. And so I had some collard green ice cream. It was interesting. It was fun. I tried some raw food. I was pushing my boundaries a little bit. I tend to believe that if you have a green, you should probably give it some fire for a few minutes. But it was awesome, you know. But I just wanted to show you all of that to give you a sense that this is not just about the past. It's about creating a future and a legacy for all of our children. One of the most things I'm the most proud of, you weren't privy to with this presentation, but I did write Paula Deen after her infamous incident. And I basically said that the most important thing we're not focusing on is the fact that we have so many great chefs of color, but they're not making it onto the Food Network. You're not hearing their voices. We have great great food writers of color. You're not hearing our voices. And therefore, you know, we're more worried about who says one word than we are about, you know, really getting the true story of where our food comes from and where it's going. I invited her to a dinner that I did on the grounds of a North Carolina plantation called Stagville, which was the largest plantation in the state's history. Over 900 individuals were enslaved there. At its peak, it was a 10,000-acre plantation. So in the shadow of the 4 remaining slave cabins in Stagville, I prepared a dinner for 150 people, only using 19th century methods, using 100% of our produce and our food came from the Piedmont of Carolina, and 40% of our food came from growers of color. And we had people of every background. We had every group. We had, you know, we had 2 million worth of Jews, which was awesome. We had Muslims, we had atheists, we had gay people, we had straight people. We had Asian, Native American, Polynesian, you name it. And I was stressed out for 3 days doing this dinner. I did not sleep. But you know what really got to me? The moment I had to, and I also got my DNA results that same day. Kind of like everything was happening, right? What got to me was, here I am. I looked at this rainbow of people of every possible color, all of us Americans. And I thought, the people who lived in those cabins could never have dreamed that 150 years later, this was what was going to be going down in the shadow of where they lived and died. And that's the best part of this work. I really do believe that the food can also lead us to peace, reconciliation, and healing of old wounds.
and that we can all be family together again. Thank you.
Kol hakavod. You know, I agree with you about goats as well. You have your programs, right? The nice photo of Michael on the cover. And you all probably just briefly looked at the bio that's in there that lists some of the publications, some of the places that he's spoken, including the Smithsonian, Colonial Williamsburg, among others. Some of you might know that he came to Sarasota directly from Austin, by Southwest. Others might know that he says it in the biography, a 2016 TED Fellow. But I think more than all those words, from hearing him, the unflinching look at history and slavery in particular, and the focus on the optimism of possibility, that we really had a rare treat tonight and a really wonderful opportunity. If people have any questions they want to raise or comments, I don't know if we have an extra microphone, but if you talk really loud, I'll repeat the question.
Microphone, sorry. So hoe cake was literally one of the forms of cornmeal cake people ate in the early South. The name tells you everything you need to know. The broad hoe, not like the garden hoe you have at Home Depot or whatever, but these broad hoes that were used to cultivate the hills for cotton and tobacco were huge, and they were heavy. So they were like this big as opposed to being this big, right? And so you could actually wash that off. And because they were cast iron like everything else, they were taken to the field. And you could unscrew it from the wood and prepare a cornmeal pancake that was just cornmeal water. That's it. Maybe salt if you were lucky. And that was like your daily bread. That was your hardtack. The hardtack of slavery was hoe cake, literally baked on the blade of the broad hoe. And since she goes in this, talking about her grandmother, you know, made this treat, and I was like, okay, Paula, I know better. See, I grew up with Natalie Dupree, New Southern Cooking, who is actually now a friend of mine. It's really weird, you know, people you're influenced by, and you end up staying at their house 30 years later. And Natalie Dupree actually was, you know, awesome. Natalie Dupree was this white lady from Georgia who had this show about Southern food. And the thing that really got me, set me off in my head, and my grandmother was still alive at this time, was that she talked about one day beaten biscuits. I'll never forget this show. And she's embarrassed of me telling this story every time, but I got to tell it. And she basically was talking about how, you know, you would beat the biscuit dough 1,000 times to bring air into it to make these biscuits. So 1,000 whacks with the back of an axe or a rolling pin. And she said that an enslaved child did this. Well, I'm 9 years old watching this program, and immediately in my head, what am I doing? Putting myself in the shoes of that child. And I went to my grandmother with everything she said and go, is this true? This, the white lady on TV said this. Is it true or not? And so that also facilitated a dialogue between my grandmother and I about what Southern food, what constituted Southern food. Because she might eat something. She never ate Country Captain, but she certainly made red rice, what they call Spanish rice. Back in Alabama, or this dish or that dish. And so that was a really cool way for me to kind of learn where I came from and what I share with other Southerners. Because another part of my project was actually looking at how white, Asian, Latino, Middle Eastern, Indian subcontinent, and Native American Southerners, we all sort of had the same stuff, but we did it in different ways. And sometimes we tweak things, you know, like this Coca-Cola brisket in Memphis, where you take the brisket and make Coca-Cola sauce and bake it in that. Or there's like Greek, most of the restaurants in Alabama were owned by Greek or Lebanese. And so what do they make? When they make Southern food, what does it taste like? You know, what are Latinos in North Carolina and Georgia? The second generation hardly speaks Spanish. They speak with a twang. And they think biscuits, are as important in their diet as tortillas. So it was this fascinating thing of learning how we, the whole Southern family, make food and, you know, talk with each other through what we make. Yeah, so with the kush, that's the bacon fat or hog fat. It's because using bacon fat came a little bit later. Because you literally had these big hunks of whatever meat with the fat on it, and having butchered and rendered hog fat, it's a kind of a grotesque process, to be honest with you. But yeah, that's an important point. I know people who are making their own bacon now. That's a big thing. Like, bacon is a boutique ingredient now in Southern gourmet restaurants. Like, they tell you where the bacon comes from. I think Benton's bacon is like the number one. And because it has Benton's bacon, that means your dish is $5 more. You know, for real. So that's that. When I do I do two kinds of cooking. My house is kosher. When I go to these sites and do historic cooking, I do the way they cooked back then. And one of the things I do to source some of the foods that I do is I'll go to these little country stores in Virginia and Georgia on the side of the road. Sometimes they're like almost tourist trappy, but they're really good. Because I'll buy these, not plastic, paper wrapped, butcher paper wrapped sides of bacon, which lasts forever. And I constantly put salt on top of them to keep the mold off. And then I use that when I go to the different plantations and cook. That's what I use in my cooking. And I'll actually render the fat from some of the side meat and put in the cast iron Dutch oven and then let it sit there for a couple hours and you get this nice layer of fat. Now, when I was growing up, my grandmother was the queen of this. I kid you not. What a fine heritage for a nice Jewish boy like me. But I'm telling you something. And we all knew we had Jewish blood in our family, but that didn't matter. We were still eating bacon. She would take that bacon grease. Now, some of you in this room know exactly what I'm about to say. That grease jar never changed. I went to elementary school. I swear to God, we moved 3 times, and that grease jar ain't never got emptied. That grease, that grease jar was like sourdough. It had a heritage to it. It had a lineage, And I mean, every single time the chicken got fried, and then back, it tasted great. But I'm telling you, it was gross. But it was the same grease jar from time immemorial forever. And by that grease jar was my grandmother's 1920s hot comb. Mm-hmm. The one that I remember summer mornings. My grandmother was obviously African-American, but a very mixed heritage. And she would sit there combing her reddish-brown hair. And I remember looking at her in the mirror and the two, greenish gray eyes looking, staring back at me and the reddish hair and the smell of burning hair and fried green tomatoes was every summer and bacon fat. Well, I think it's a fantastic question. The first part, I'll answer it backwards. The young people, it's kind of like the best education sometimes is when the young people are the teachers and they go and they, because a lot of times they set the tone. They set the tone for dinner or for meals. If they're not going to eat it, it's not like I was at the tail end. If you don't eat it, you don't eat. But that didn't work for me too long. My breaking point was okra. Now I eat okra because I eat it fresh. I grow it, right? But when I was, sometimes it was frozen or something else. It was nasty. It was slimy. And my grandmother made me sit down one time and eat the okra, and I would not eat it. And it was like, it was a 6-hour, stand down between me and that okra. But the bottom line is you eat what kids will set the tone. So these young people actually eating this better food, which is the same tradition, nothing wrong with it. They're actually going home and saying to their grandmother and grandmother, mother and the father, why don't we make dinner? It tastes better. And number two, why don't we make the things you like to make? And three, why don't we make them a certain way? So it's not, they learned the deep frying thing was actually a Sunday dinner thing, if not a couple times a year. It was not a weekly thing. That was a special food. And if you look at most of our cultures, we're mistaking celebration food for everyday food. Sunday gravy was not everyday food in Italian American houses. It was Sunday dinner food that the grandmother would make. Because you were in America and because you could get your hands on different kinds of meats and feed a big family. But that is not the same thing as every single night has to be Sunday gravy. And it's the same thing in any culture. So we have to learn that. Celebration food is great, it is wonderful, and don't you dare make it, any other kind of way. You must fry the chicken, don't oven fry it. But that is a celebratory food. That is not every day for dinner. The everyday meals of most of our ancestors were actually quite economical, healthy, and responsible, and frugal, you know, not wasting food. So the kids are doing the outreach and the teaching, but it's important that we take that to schools and not just have it be community outreach, because we know that's the captive audience for a lot of our children, and churches as well. A lot of churches are doing this kind of outreach and work. Well, that's great, but, you know, it's going to take a lot more effort on our part. The first question, I think the problem is gatekeepers. And it's not just, and it's weird because a lot of these things aren't being gatekept in the South. It's actually in New York and LA. They don't get it. When I was selling the cooking gene, we sold it to HarperCollins, which is great, which is awesome. But before then, we had another publisher who is really hot right now in terms of food and really well-respected. They make award-winning books, you know, like that. The problem is that when they saw a black Jewish guy, you know, who happens to be gay, doing all this stuff, they were like, uh-huh. So it was okay for me to be black and preach to other black people about you, thou shalt. People love books like that. They love that kind of mess. But when I said I'm Jewish, the Jewish editor said to me, watch this. She said to me, oh, but America's not ready for you. Girl, I am America. My America was waiting for you when your people got off the boat and came to America. Are you kidding me? So that's a gatekeeper thing. Your story, you know, one of my friends is from Georgia and she moved to New York. And she wanted to talk about how she came from Athens, Georgia. She's this food writer in New York. Her and she cooks for her husband and wanted to write all about how, like, a cookbook, all about how she's getting all these Korean and Jewish and Italian influences in her cooking. They wouldn't let her write it that way. They just want her to do the same old soul food book that had been done before and put, you know, be sassy and cute. And finally, she found a publisher that would give her most of what she wanted to do. But, I mean, you're not even able to tell authentic stories. We're not living in that past. I have my own reality, my own future, my own identity. And if I don't, I told several people, if I don't write about it my way, it's like if I, when I die, it's like somebody like me never existed. And that's heartbreaking. Because as a historian, I know damn well that there are limitations. If they don't find you in the written record, and in the ground, you don't exist. So you get erased from history. So I want them to know there was this fabulous black gay Jewish chef that lived in the 21st century who was doing it. You know, that got his. And so I told that, so they told my agent, said, we don't want him to wear a kippah in public. We don't want him to wear a yarmulke. We don't really want him to talk about being Jewish. And so I had my Sandy Koufax moment. I told him to kiss my tuchus. That's that.
You
are mine. Ah, right.
Please, a round of applause for Michael, and thank you all for coming tonight.
The funny thing about this,